Now, you see, of course, I would say a lot of things about Ken Wilber's model and ideas, how they are intellectually possible, but they are not intently possible. You know, that's intellectually they are possible. You are going to speak. Well, why don't you speak?
I'm trying to get my notebook so I can write.
So, there's the intent, you know, that's what it is. Now, consciousness, you know, that we arbitrarily divide these consciousnesses into subconscious, unconscious and conscious. We arbitrarily divide that. Who divides these things? You know, who divides all those things? It's the consciousness itself.
Right.
You know, it divides. It arbitrarily divides all those things. And you have got a consciousness, you say, there is something which I don't know which is unconscious, and there is something comes through the unconscious in some conscious. You know, that's what that we generally say about it. Now, see this. Now, what happened? We cannot recognize the consciousness because we are consciousness itself. So, we are not separate from consciousness, so we cannot recognize it as a separate entity. You know, apart from us, there is no separate entity. Consciousness is not a separate entity. Apart from us, I am that I am. Right? So, you cannot divide that. But for argument's sake, or putting some ideas, throwing some ideas and everything that people can follow, we have, from time immemorial, people have followed certain track, what you call track, you know. And the track attracts, you know. the track really attracts, you know. Now, this Richard has got a soundtrack, you know. He's going to put the new house a soundtrack. I'm going to be a Hollywood star. Soundtrack will be there. So now the whole thing comes, you know, the simple thing, as you said, as I always say, be good, do good. It sums up the whole thing of human expanse. That sums up the whole thing. Be good, do good. That's the only thing that you can do. Other things are, you know, it may be colors and all those things. We cannot see the colors in consciousness, surely not. Unless you are drugged. You'll not be able to see colors in consciousness. You know, I have not met Ken Wilber, as a matter of fact, but I met his wife, who has had cancer, and, you know, she had, they can come for some advice, and he was sitting in a cave-like place. He had shaven and everything. He became Buddhist at the time. And I did give some advice to his wife. And this is the last stage. You take the name of God. Nothing else you can do. No medicine can help. No treatment can help. Nobody spiritual or whoever it is cannot come and help you. Even God will come and help you. Will not. So this is the last stage. Why the last stage? Because you are supposed to leave this body and go to a higher stage. And is it possible, is it always the case that you leave the body to go to a higher stage? In some case it is. It is because our soul or whatever the inner essence is, it is confined to this frame, what you call, with bones and flesh and skin, is confined to it. This is a cage. We are confined in a cage. Our soul is confined in this cage. So, some people cannot give it up because of great attachment to certain things in the worldly things. So, it has to take place. There the death has a say in its own glory. Death has a say, you know. And also suffering and everything have a say in all these things. Now, supposing that we follow all these things, Ken Wilber is a very, very intellectual person. I tell you that because I didn't read all his books, but I know certain things coming from the Enlightenment, that magazine, you know. I saw a dialogue between Cohen and Ken Wilber, you know. And in one of his remarks, he said Aurobindo had not reached the stage where he could, you know, give a panacea or a solution to the world. He said that in Ken Wilber, he said in his book, in one of his books, he said that. You know, so it's all right. Aurobindo was he was old man, you know, at that time when all these people came on the stage of this world. I don't think Ken Wilber was born when Aurobindo died. In 50s, you know, he died. And I had met him in the 30s, you know, that was, I was born, you know. And I was born and reborn and everything, that's what happened. And I met Aurobindo. I met in a very humorous way. And that was my way of approaching a higher personality or a very famous personality or even God. I got a humorous way of reaching God. You know, I don't contort my face and everything and complain to him and no. I said, my dad, if you want to do this thing for me, you do it. Otherwise, don't speak. Don't interfere. You know, I'll do myself. You don't interfere. That's my way of reaching my dad. You know this. And he agrees with that. He says, I'll not interfere. You do. Easy. But give me some energy, and he gives me energy. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And once in a vision, he gave me energy in a lotus flower. He presses. This is the vision I tell you. I did not be true or false. I am not going to talk about it. But this is the vision. You believe it or not, I don't care. You know, this is the vision. His one hand comes. You know, a lotus flower. And lotus flower that actually it explodes into numerous energy and colors and everything and enters me. You know, that's the way he gives me energy. You know, he's also very humorous way he gives. Why should he give a lotus color and all this, all different colors exploding around me and entering me and all this? He could have simply said, all right, have this energy. No, he won't say that also, you know. He's very strict about his own attitude and multitudinal attitude he has got. It is multitudinal, you know, it is not just one attitude, it is multitudinal. So, right, so, now what happened, the simple things they taught was how to, you know, correct yourself, how to make a progress. Therefore, I was singing that, I knew Gippy was going to say this, and I sang that, you know, you can save. The dawn saves the morning saves the day saves the eventide, and the eventide or the dusk saves the night, and the night saves the morning again. It's a cycle. It goes on like that. So, see, just think about it, what I sang, you know, it is extempore. It came to me when I was just entering the door, you know, after giving a piece of bread to Pepper and Major, you know. Okay.
After saving them.
Yeah. So it came to me. You can save. You can save. And all these things save, you know. They don't destroy each other, but they save each other. You must know that. Otherwise, the morning does not destroy the day does not destroy the evening does not destroy the night. No, they save them. You know, as a mutual cooperation. And all this phenomenal, you know, world that God has created, see, and he has kept all the meaning in every action and every act of nature itself, you know, nature itself. So, the simple thing what the Indian scripture said in the beginning, you know, satyam vada dharmam chara, that means speak the truth and follow the law, the cosmic law. See, it's very simple. Now you can say, what is the law? What is the law? Now you have got 10 commandments in the Christian world, and you have got Job's words in the Jewish world. All the Job's very beautiful things are there. It was Job. And then you have, if you go deeper into that, you have got the Dead Sea Scroll, because the scroll was hidden in the sea when it died. It became completely gone. So these things were stored in that in jars, because in those days people, invaders or the opposite people of the opposition would come and destroy them. You know, that's what happened in Indian scriptures. Half of them are destroyed, you must know that. So whatever remaining is more than the half. See, it is the whole. It is greater than the sum total of what he destroyed. Okay, so so that's that Dead Sea Scroll. Then you have the American Indians. scriptures are there. You know, they have, they are spoken words. It's not, they didn't write or anything. You know, if they're, in the Indians wrote it on some palm leaves, you know, on palm leaves. They didn't have papers and everything in those days. But it was actually conveyed to people by mouth, you know. And a teacher, when they found a disciple very worthy and worthy of receiving more instruction from him, he will just talk to him in his ears, so that nobody will hear that in his ears. He will give the instruction in his ear, he will speak. But if your ear is deaf, you will not hear it. I mean, okay, so in his ear, he would just say in his ear. So nobody would hear that. Because what happens if somebody hears that who is not worthy of it, who has not reached the stage where he can make use of it, you know, then he will miscommunicate and mistreat and give a wrong impression to others. Therefore, nobody could hear that. And they, you know, disciples, they, the teachers were so compassionate in that sense. And they never used to ask them, get out. Go out of the school, I want to talk to him. They would not say that. Then the other student, oh, there is something secret this teacher gave to him. Oh, he is the worthy person. I must be worthy. So they will actually become inspired by that very act. I must become worthy and, you know, to receive that. So they will try to become worthy. You know. So it was a very sympathetic and cooperative, conducive, and liberal act of grace on the part of the teacher. Therefore, they used to worship the teacher, and you know, on Guru Purnima, it will come sometime in August. So they used to, you know, worship the gurus, you know, at that time with flowers and offerings and all those things.